Welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Delighted to be with you on this Wednesday afternoon. And we have a very special program for you today. Very special guest, someone who is very special to us, and I believe you will find as well. Don Eden Goldstein has a brand new book out for Catholic Answers Press. It's called Sunday Will Never Be the Same. A rock and roll journalist opens her ears to God. Don is a professor of theology in the online division of Holy Apostles University, and the author of many things, once a, what should we say, a follower of bands who wrote lots of wonderful journalism about music, and lived, well, was raised in a Jewish home, lived as a secular agnostic for a good part of her life, came to the Christian faith, came to the Catholic faith. And came so far in, she's now got her doctorate in it. Don Eden Goldstein, thank you for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me on, Cy.
So your book is a story. It's your story. And this is an unusual thing for Catholic Answers Press to undertake. Why would you, maybe if you could just, what is it about telling a story that you think is effective as sharing the faith? Because that's really what we're about here at Catholic Answers, is sharing, explaining, and defending the faith. So why did you choose this? Because you can write all kinds of genres. Why the autobiographical?
That's a great question. Well, I originally didn't want to write an autobiography. When I became Catholic, and actually even before I became Catholic, when I was what I now call a transitional Protestant, people were telling me that I should share my story in a book. And I was reluctant because I thought that it meant writing about, you know, everything I ever did, what I did this year and that year and this year and the next year and so on. And it wasn't until I had a conversation with my friend Kevin Turley, who's an English Catholic journalist, that I understood that this was something I was capable of doing. Kevin told me first that I should tell my story, and then when I gave him the reasons why I didn't want to, he said that I was confusing memoir with autobiography. He said that if I were writing an autobiography, then I would be expected to give all that historical background. But he said that with memoir, you only tell the things that you want to tell. And I thought, well, there are a lot of things that I want to tell. So that's how this book, Sunday Will Never Be the Same, came about. What I really wanted to do was talk about moments of grace in my life. I wanted to talk about how God was always trying to break through, even when I was far from him. And then finally, he broke through. So it's like a book about being chased by the hound of heaven until I eventually get you know, joyfully caught.
So there, your name is important. I have introduced you as Don Eden Goldstein. That's the name on the book.
Yes.
But you ran away from your name for a while, at least the last part there, and you wanted to be called Don Eden. You published under the name Don Eden for most of your life. What's the name about? Why the drama about your name?
Well, you know, I think that for people who are raised Jewish, especially in a place, you know, like the United States and in Galveston, Texas, where I was as a child too, you have that sense of being other, being different. And I would tell people my name was Dawn Goldstein. And, you know, they'd make some joke, oh, nice Jewish girl, you know, or whatever. And, you know, it's natural for people to want to have some hook that can help them to have a conversation topic. But, you know, it can also, you know, lead to, you know, all kinds of prejudices. So, you know, like one of the popular prejudices, well, I don't have to name them even, but you know, some prejudices are things that could be called positive. Some prejudices, many of them are, you know, sadly, are with the history of anti-Semitism, are things that are negative. And when I was a teenager, just in high school, I realized that my parents had given me this great name. I was born in 1968, the era of the flower child. And so my parents thought, we'll name her Dawn Eden, like, you know, the dawn of Eden.
Yeah, yeah.
And I realized with that great first and middle name, why not just use that as my pen name? So that became my pen name as a rock and roll journalist, and then I just carried it into my work as a Christian and eventually, praise God, Catholic author. And then after I when I was about to receive my doctorate in sacred theology from the University of St. Mary of the Lake Mundelein Seminary in 2016, I just thought, I've been running away from my Jewish identity for a long time. And, you know, it really, the fact that I'm able to get a doctorate really speaks to the fact that I'm the great-grandchild of immigrants who worked so hard so that their kids and grandkids and great-grandkids could get college education. So I decided it was time for me to take back Goldstein. And also with, you know, very sadly, again, the return of anti-Semitism, I thought that it was important that I identify with anyone who's being persecuted. And so now as a Jew and as a Catholic, I have identification with persecuted people around the world.
Yeah, fair enough. Now, but I wonder how much of your, well, first of all, they gave you the 1968 name, Dawn Eden, it sounds like it might have been a close thing that you could have been Dawn Aquarius Goldstein. Was that ever in the running, or that didn't
the
come up?
The dawn of the age of Aquarius. My parents did have the Hair soundtrack, and I know from them, I believe, that the Hair musical, they had the original cast album, and I know from them that although the original cast album was a bestseller, it's considered a classic. On Broadway did not know how to use microphones on rock and roll singers and musicians.
Yeah.
So you could hear it much better on the album than if you saw it live, according to my parents.
So, but you were hearing this rock and roll music from then a very young age, being played in
yes.
the home.
Yep. So, yes, yes. My mother loves to say that the first album I heard was the soundtrack to The Graduate, and that from birth, all she had to do was play that soundtrack and I would calm down, the Simon and Garfunkel music.
Yeah, but I wonder if your desire to be Dawn Eden is also reflective of hurts that happened to you as a child. I mean, I guess none of us have an unmixed relationship with our childhood faith. But you can certainly, there are lots of people who would say, I had the happiest Jewish upbringing. I'm so, you know, there's a kind of, it, you know, wonderful thing that happens growing up Jewish. I wonder if that was maybe not the case for you.
Well, I never had any issue with my Jewish faith. I had an issue with things that happened to me that were associated with going to temple. Certainly had issues, you know, with the fact that as a child at the age of five, I suffered sexual molestation by a janitor at the temple. And when my mother went to the rabbi, he did nothing because the janitor denied it, and it was his word against mine. You know, the rabbi tells me today that you know, now he deeply regrets that. He certainly would have done things differently, but, you know, that was a negative experience. Then at the age of 12, when I was preparing for my bat mitzvah, I had questions about my bat mitzvah Torah portions, and I was told, you know, by the rabbi, oh, you know, people spend their lives studying Talmud, you know, don't even bother trying to discover what these Torah portions mean, just learn how to chant them and get your bat mitzvah over with, you know, get the ceremony over with, essentially. So I had feelings of not being validated, not being believed or respected.
Yeah.
So, you know, in that sense, now that I write about healing from childhood sexual abuse, as I've done in my previous books, My Peace I Give You and Remembering God's Mercy, even though I didn't grow up in a Catholic family and I never had an experience of abuse in the church, I can certainly identify with people who were put off from the church, not because they were actually put off by Jesus or right. by what the church teaches, but by people in the church.
That's what's so striking is you had this experience that we now, I mean, in the public mind, and not without justification, this kind of religious sexual molestation thing is associated with Catholics. This is a very painful, horrible time because those two things have become associated. And you come into the Catholic faith with that experience and also with, I guess, an empathy for those who have suffered, which we need.
Yes.
I mean, there's been too much excuse-making, certainly.
Yes.
And, I mean, I suppose all of us at some point, when we first start hearing these things, we are defensive. And I can remember myself being defensive in the late 90s, early 2000s, when you start hearing these things about what is this, and is this just a media concoction and all that. But you come to us, you enter the Catholic Church, I guess, with a special gift born of your own suffering.
Well, thank you. I mean, you know, it's funny, one doesn't think of being a survivor of childhood sexual abuse as being a gift. But, you know, certainly for me, I have had a great gift in terms of being able to speak to people experientially
yes.
about healing from childhood sexual abuse. And secondly, and this is something that I think one spends a lifetime trying to appreciate, it's not something that comes easily, but I have the gift of faith in Jesus Christ and of communion in His church, and I honestly cannot say that if I hadn't suffered childhood sexual abuse, that I would recognize how much I need Jesus. I have relatives, cousins, who are my age, and to my knowledge, they didn't suffer abuse or other kinds of trauma in childhood, and they have reasonably happy lives, and they are, you know, to varying degrees, reasonably secure in practice of their Jewish faith. So,
yes.
with those points of comparison, I honestly, you know, don't know. It doesn't seem, you know, as likely that I would have recognized my need for God if I didn't have these wounds. My need for Jesus, I should say.
Right, indeed. That's an extraordinary thing to say. You put me in the mind of St. Paquita, who said similar things about slavery, where it's not a matter
yes.
of this is a good thing that happened, not at all, but it is
right.
a matter of coming to meet Christ under, I want to say under unusual circumstances, but you would wish they'd be more unusual, I suppose. But Don, we have to take a break. Don Eden Goldstein is the author of the brand new book from Catholic Answers Press, which I will highly recommend to you as a wonderful read. Even if you get nothing else out of it, just the enjoyment of a great read, you will get that. I can guarantee it, but you'll also get much more. Sunday Will Never Be the Same. A rock and roll journalist opens her ears to God. If you'd like to talk with Don, 888-318-7884. What I meant was, if you'd like to talk with Professor Goldstein, 888-318-7884. We'll take a quick break and be right back with more right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Live is proudly supported by CatholicChemistry.com, a new dating site for Catholics who want to do dating right and believe relationships start with Catholic chemistry. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicChemistry.com for their generous support on the web at CatholicChemistry.com.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious mystic monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All Mystic Monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase Mystic Monk coffee, visit MysticMonkCoffee.com. That's MysticMonkCoffee.com.
Catholic radio, I believe, is the greatest tool for evangelization that the church has today. And I know this because we hear from people all over the world that tell us all the time they came to faith in Christ, in the Catholic Church, through Catholic radio. Guy that lives right next door to you, he might not ask you about your Catholic faith, but he'll ask us. He'll call in and say, tell me about the Catholic Church.
Dr. David Anders thinks Catholic radio is important. So should you.
Dawn Eden Goldstein is our guest this hour, and we are delighted to have her to talk about her brand new book, Sunday Will Never Be the Same, A Rock and Roll Journalist Opens Her Ears to God. So the American secular religion is the flag and apple pie and mom and all of that. And then America developed a second secular religion in the middle 1950s, I suppose, with Elvis Presley and Fats Domino and all the crowd. So when did you get baptized, I suppose, into the second the second religion of America, rock and roll?
Well, it certainly started when I was in the womb, as I said to you earlier. I mean, when my mother was listening to the Simon and Garfunkel's soundtrack for The Graduate back then, and then, you know, I went through my mom's record collection as a child, got into the Beatles, the Moody Blues, and then I started to discover pop music of the mid-60s. My mother had a collection of the K-Tel, you know, number one hits, like a collection, number one hits of the 60s. And then somehow I just stayed in that golden period of the mid-60s, I like to say the post-Camelot, pre-hippie 60s.
Yeah.
And that just became my era. And through, you know, my last 2 years of high school, through college, I just was obsessing on that music. And by then, it was well after, you know, that era. You know, I was born in 1968. I'm Generation X. And, you know, as you may know, Cy, we are the smallest generation.
Oh, we are?
Yes,
I didn't know
we are.
That.
We're squeezed by the boomers and now the millennials.
Oh, yeah. We have a weird identity, our group.
We do. We have a very weird identity. And in my generation, when I was entering New York University in 1985, one of the things that my generation did to differentiate itself was that some people in my generation found this 60s garage band music and started their own neo garage bands. And so in Sunday will never be the same. Pardon me for doing the QVC thing. I love that.
Hold it up. Hold it up for the camera.
Exactly.
I got
exactly.
It.
Exactly. Thank you. Yes. So in my new memoir, Sunday Will Never Be the Same, I tell about entering into this neo garage scene as a teenager in New York City in the late 1980s. And I mean, this scene, it was barely a blip on the national consciousness, but it was so popular for those who are part of it that they keep up Facebook groups, you know, to this day, just rehashing what happened in just a couple of slivers of years where there were was a nightclub called The Dive that would have these bands that would relive the age of one-hit wonders like, you know, the Standells and the Chocolate Watch Band, and sort of rehash those songs or rewrite them in new ways.
Is that why when I follow you on Twitter and I find myself, okay, so you will make some observation about the current state of the church or something the Pope said or something, often it's something someone said about the Pope, and then there's a band gets mentioned and I have to go look them up. I don't know who they are. So that's why that's happening. It's not that I'm somehow out of it. It's that you are an aficionado of 1960s one-hit wonders.
One-hit wonders wonders, no hit wonders, obscure British invasion, garage psychedelic stuff, the Brill Building pop, but the Brill Building pop that was sort of below the radar that didn't hit. But yeah, that whole era. So I became a rock and roll historian, and I go into that in much detail in Sunday Will Never Be the Same. I talk about how I discovered the music of this record producer named Kurt Betcher. He's best known for producing the Association hits Along Comes Mary and Cherish. I discovered these psychedelic albums that he worked on by groups called the Millennium and Sagittarius. And then I talk about how I felt like I, as a teenager, at the age of 18, 19, that I had to tell the world Kurt Betcher's story. So I tried to find him, only to find out that he had died just by the time I got information about him, he had died just 6 months earlier at a young age. And so I decided, well, I'm going to then keep his legacy alive by telling his story. And although I never wrote the book I had hoped to write on Kurt Betcher, I did end up writing a number of articles. And when the CD era came about in the 90s, I wrote liner notes, the booklets to CDs of his music. So the funny thing is, you know, now if you go to Wikipedia, there's a huge entry on Kurt Betcher, B-O-E-T-T-C-H-E-R. And there are literally dozens of CDs from around the world of his music, obscure music that didn't hit. And these CDs come from places like Japan, England, United States. But at the time that I started researching him, there were maybe 100 people around the world who really collected his music. But, you know, in Sunday Will Never Be the Same, I talk about how God used that obsession that I had with this dead 1960s record producer. I talk about how God used that to keep me alive at a time when I was suffering the wounds of undiagnosed PTSD, having suicidal thoughts. And my way of staying alive was to have hope that one day, you know, I want to cry now because this, my hope happened, it came to be, but this was my hope that one day people would care about this record producer who died in obscurity. I get goosebumps thinking about it.
It's this is what I find so striking about the book, and I do think that when people pick up and read Sunday Will Never Be the Same, it's your ability to point out, or not just point out, but to let us live with you the way often our own obsessions or our own what seemingly very secular interests have underneath them a spiritual quest that can either be frustrated or it can ultimately be fully satisfied.
That's very well said. You know, I don't want listeners hearing this to just think, oh, this is another case of Beauty Will Save the World, or this is another case of a Catholic speaker saying that you can take, you know, the movie Titanic or the U2 song Desire and just read it in a Catholic way. That's not what I do in Sunday Will Never Be the Same, because I don't believe that beauty will save the world. I believe that Jesus Christ, our Lord Jesus Christ, has saved the world and you know will you know save it through his church, but I do believe that in things that are not of themselves objectively sinful, so you know we're not talking about things like drugs or pornography, but in things that are you know in some way neutral. Like, you know, a beautiful song, even if it's a secular song, that God can use these things to spark a longing in us, that if we follow that longing, you know, by his grace, that can lead us to God.
That's right. That's beautiful, and I think I'm so happy to hear that your confession that Christ is the Savior. That it's not beauty, although there's nothing that's not beautiful about Christ.
Right.
It's all
right.
But it strikes me that In telling it, in showing your experience of it, there is a window open that says these things are pointing towards your desire for ultimate fulfillment, and
yes.
and Christ's commandments, you know, Christ's and it also coming from the Hebrew scriptures, this idea that we're made to love God and love neighbor. Those two things also are the deepest longings that we have. We want community with our neighbor, and we want God. So I know the music's going to start playing here. So, and I do want to take calls. 888-318-7884 is the number. And if you're on the line, I'll get to you when we come back. But we're changing up a little bit today, our usual format, because Catholic Answers Press has changed up its usual format in publishing the extraordinary memoir from Don Eden Goldstein, Sunday Will Never Be the Same. A rock and roll journalist opens her ears to God. Again, 888-318-7884, the number. We'll be right back with more with Don Eden Goldstein right after this.
Yo, hi everybody. This is Dion, the Wanderer. Hey, you want to know when I keep it on Catholic Answers Live? I feel at home. God bless. Stay well.
In his new audio presentation, The Very First Fathers, apologist Jimmy Akin takes you on a tour of the earliest Christian writings outside the New Testament. From the most famous figures and most notable works to those lesser known but no less important, this pivotal time in the development of the early church is revealed in fascinating detail. Jimmy shows how, even in the first century after the resurrection, it was necessary to defend and explain truths that are still under attack today, such as the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist and the perpetual virginity of Mary. The Very First Fathers is a compelling look at the dawn of the Christian age and edifying listening for anyone who wants to understand and defend the full truth of Catholicism. Order your copy of The Very First Fathers today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Love and beauty. As a little girl, Dawn Eden Goldstein knew that she wanted those things, that in them somehow she would find God. Over the years as a rock journalist, she moved among some of popular music's best-known artists, straining to capture that transcendent love and beauty in every note and lyric. In Sunday Will Never Be the Same, Dawn recounts her spiritual journey in beautifully wrought detail, mixing powerful accounts of trauma, healing, and epiphany with funny anecdotes from inside the music scene. It is the rare conversion story that delights as it inspires, amuses as it edifies, and ultimately lays before the reader a lived testimony to the transforming grace of Christ. Order your copy of Sunday Will Never Be the Same by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host, and delighted to be talking with Dawn Eden Goldstein today about her brand new book, Sunday Will Never Be the Same, A Rock and Roll Journalist Opens Her Ears to God. I don't think Todd Agliolaro, the publisher here at Catholic Answers Press, would have looked for a book like this from most people. I think Todd is a fan of very good writing. That's one thing. And it's just a little bit not what we usually do here at Catholic Answers. We're kind of almost a purely, in many ways, intellectual apostolate in that we answer people's questions about the Catholic faith. And storytelling is certainly an intellectual undertaking, but it has other aspects to it, too. So I guess all of that is to just say, if Todd Agliolaro is willing to publish it at Catholic Answers Press, it's got to be a heck of a book, because it's different from what he usually publishes. And so much to talk about as far as rock and roll and the artists that you have gotten to interview, some that you have not gotten to interview, who were just as important in many ways. But I want to let some callers talk with you for a minute. So we'll. All right.
Great.
Debbie, you are up first today. Your comment or question for Dawn Eden Goldstein.
Hi, Debbie. Hello. Hi, Dawn. I just wanted to thank you for your book, My Peace I Give You. I have not read your current book, but I will be sure to. I am in my late 50s, suffered through abuse as a child, at the hands of my stepfather. I've attempted suicide a couple of times during my life. And just a year ago, I joined the Catholic Church. I have found my greatest peace I have ever known by joining the Catholic Church.
Praise God.
It makes me speechless at times because I can't even express to anyone. I had such a dark soul, and I was such an angry and depressed person. And when my heart opened up to the Catholic Church, my whole entire world changed. Mm-hmm. So I want to thank you for your book, because your book helped me find that peace and the ability to forgive the perpetrator and to be able to move on and not dwell on the past.
Oh, Debbie, you just gave me goosebumps, and, you know, I have goosebumps and I want to cry at the same time. So a full body reaction there. I'm so grateful to you for telling me about this, grateful to God for leading you into His church, and for God's using my book as an instrument. Thank you so much for telling me that. Can I ask you, how do you hear about my piece I give you?
Because when I started to go through my confirmation classes through the Catholic Church, when I was starting to my journey to join the church, I listened to Catholic radio on my way back and forth to work every day. And you were on one time, and I was listening to you and listening about your history and this book, and I ordered it, read it, and it just brought me such, in combination, of course, with Jesus and a little help from Him, it helped me find the ability to forgive and to let go of that and let God take me down this path that is a much happier and brighter place to be.
Amen. Amen. Well, thank you so much for sharing that with me. I just thank God that He reached you in that way. And, you know, that's really, you know, God's grace. You know, God's grace can work through a radio show. You know, He finds us, and I'm just really, really touched that that He found you, not just through that radio show, but in many ways, and led you to His love in the church. Thank you for sharing that with me.
Thank you, Debbie.
Thank you so much.
God bless you.
Wow. It is true. There is healing in the Lord, and I don't know that we talk about it enough. Like, people sometimes will call, well, God won't take this away from me, and you think about Debbie talking about a darkness of soul, and He does. He can. He has the power to heal. I do think, like, I'm a big fan of one song. I'll tell you this right now. It's called "That's All Right," and it was recorded by Elvis Presley in 1954. Because I think the whole world changed the day that Elvis recorded that song. And,
yes.
And the thing about Elvis is he was also a gospel singer, and he made beautiful gospel albums. I think sometimes they're a little sugary, but they're beautiful gospel albums.
Yes.
And so I think for a lot of people in the generations that have come since then, there's a time in their life when rock and roll music plays a really big role. And it has to do with that, I don't know, the kind of anomy of the modern world, the way it's so isolating and leaves. I mean, teenagers, they have every way of being connected now, and they're so lonely.
Yes.
And a song has the power to change that, if just temporarily. Is that part of what drew you, do you think, now looking back on it, to rock music and to your wanting to be in the scene, so to speak?
There is a sense, you know, when you hear a great song that you just want to live inside that song, that the song just captures an experience, a feeling. And there's the knowledge whenever you hear a song that expresses your heart that some person, some human being conceived that song And so you have a connection with that person. You know, that's why sometimes people can take it to, you know, obsessions with rock stars.
Yeah.
You know, there can be a strong fantasy element in it for the listener where they project their own feelings. But there's also, you know, something, ideally, there's something good in that these songs tell people that they're not alone. You know, there's a kind of a conundrum there with respect to certain songs that are very dark and that are by, you know, performers who had dark endings, such as, you know, I was never really into Nirvana, but, you know, but like, you know, Kurt Cobain or you know, going back earlier to the music of the era that I like, Phil Oakes or Judy Sill, who were artists from the 60s and 70s. There's a conundrum with respect to that when these people express severely depressed or suicidal thoughts in their music, can that help the listener or can it harm the listener? For some listeners, it can be a release because they now know that there's somebody else who feels the same way. You know, that's why on Facebook now, on social media, you see these posts saying, please copy this post so that people know there's someone listening. Suicide awareness, because people who are suicidal believe that they're the only one, and they don't realize that there's someone else out there who understands and who's sympathetic.
Right.
But at the same time, you know, if music is coming from a dark place, it can also lead people into a dark place. So there's a double-edged sword there. I think we do need to be careful in terms of what we've take in. You know, the maxim garbage in, garbage out is true.
Yeah.
But there's also, you know, if we moderate things so that we're not, you know, all goth all the time, so to speak, I think in moderation there can be a benefit to listening to dark or sad things, like, you know, certain movements of, I think, Beethoven's symphony, is it the second movement of the Eroica? That's the funeral march.
Yeah.
You know, some of that stuff in moderation can, even though it's dark, can actually bring us up because it's taking us out of isolation.
Right. Okay. So, but I'm thinking of, let's go to, you mentioned U2 at a certain point. And so here's a band that's in some form Christian, or at least trying to convey Christian messages.
Yes.
Certainly seem to conceive of themselves as Christian. I'm not exactly sure. I don't know the whole story of them, but there's a Christian element to what they're doing, I guess.
Yeah.
And then if you see so you think this is very positive, they have this music that really touches people and really means something to people, but you watch a U2 concert and you say, there's something about that that is liturgical, and there's something about that that seems to be even worshipful of the musicians themselves, of Bono the singer, or of the songs.
Yes.
Do you see what I'm saying? That there is something beautifully soulful in rock and roll music. I do think a lot of it comes from its gospel and blues roots, but that there's also an element in which you can, I suppose it's like, you know, there's something wonderful about Scotch whiskey, but if Scotch whiskey becomes everything to you, you got a serious problem. Do you see where I'm going with that?
Yes, I do. I was at a concert of one of my very favorite bands ever, the Zombies, a reunion concert of theirs about 8 years ago. And I was having feelings of transcendence then that were, you know, sort of like my younger self, you know, because I love the Zombies from college. But as a Catholic, having those feelings and looking at the band on stage, it struck me that the rise of the Beatles in the 60s paralleled Vatican II and the turn from what liturgists call odd orientum, which is where the priest is facing the liturgical east, facing the tabernacle,
right.
And versus populum, where the priest faces the people, and that the experience, I think, you know, if you go before the Beatles, what did you have? You had Sing Along with Mitch, where you see Mitch Miller's back, except for between songs when he says, now we're going to sing along with such
and such. Interesting. Yeah, right.
You know, you have the age of the band leaders where you're really seeing their back.
Yeah. I'm sympathetic to that point, in part because I don't know anything about liturgical reform, but if I could do one thing, it would be to restore ad orientem. I just think there's something so obviously magnificent about that and godly about it. So you're saying, yeah, this whole turn to the self,
yes.
and that the performer becomes the icon, really, of...
It becomes a closed circle. That's what Ratzinger speaks about in The Spirit of the Liturgy, when he speaks about the difference in experience between seeing, being at Mass where everyone, including the priest, is facing Jesus in the tabernacle, and the experience when the priest faces the people, you're taking something that's directed outwards and upwards with facing Jesus, and you're turning it into a closed circle. Well, that's what a rock concert does versus, say, a classical concert. That's how it's a different experience. And you can have a high by thinking, aren't we great? You can get a kind of exhilarating, you know, feeling out of that. But the high is not necessarily going to take you into the same place psychologically. Now, of course, the Mass is the Mass, so a Mass with the priest facing the people is going to take you exactly to the same place in terms of communion with Jesus as a Mass ad orientem. But in terms of the psychological experience, going back to the rock concert versus classical image, you know, that high is not necessarily going to take you psychologically where it would if your eyes were not, you know, facing this other human being, but your eyes were free to envision what the music is conjuring up, as you do at a classical concert.
Dawn Eden Goldstein is our guest. Her brand new book, a new turn for Catholic Answers Press, and so we're taking it a little bit differently today on Catholic Answers Live to talk with Dawn. The book is Sunday Will Never Be the Same, A Rock and Roll Journalist Opens Her Ears to God. We haven't actually talked about so many of these acts that you love and the people you got to talk to as a rock journalist. I want to do that when we come back. I want to encourage folks on the phone, don't go away. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back and let you talk first to Dawn before I continue doing one of my favorite things in the world, talking with Dawn Eden Goldstein, right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Harry Connick Jr., and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Do you love praying for people? Have you ever wanted to use your gift of prayer to share Jesus with others and build up the body of Christ? Start a public prayer station with St. Paul Street Evangelization. Listen to people's needs, pray with them, or invite them to meet you at church. St. Paul Street Evangelization can help you get started. Find out how at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
He is honored by the Church as a saint with the title of the Angelic Doctor.
Matthew Bunsen and the Doctors of the Church.
St. Thomas Aquinas wrote a basic textbook for young theology students that became the Church's most famous guide to the faith, the Summa Theologica. It helped him earn the title Doctor of the Church. He died in 1274.
For more about the Doctors of the Church, visit doctorsofthechurch.com.
Don Eden Goldstein, our guest. Her brand new book, I highly recommend it to you. You won't be sorry you did. Sunday Will Never Be the Same. A rock and roll journalist opens her ears to God. Anonymous caller didn't want to go on the air, said the following to you, Don. I struggle with certain sexual sins. After confession one day, my priest gave me my peace. I give to you, and it has helped me immensely. Thank you. Thank you. I can't wait to read Sunday Will Never Be the Same.
Isn't that beautiful? Praise God.
Yeah, we're lucky to have you, Don. Let's go to Bert in Michigan. Bert wants to talk to you, and I don't think he's got a lot of time. So, Bert, your question or comment for Don Eden Goldstein.
Hi, Bert.
Hello. Hello, Don. Do you hear me?
Yes, I do.
Oh, I'm sorry. I just want to make sure. Oh, I'm so glad I got on with you. I am so, oh, my God. When I heard about your book, it was almost like I wrote this book when I heard the description. Long story short, I grew up in a musical household. My father was a musician. Now I got a daughter that's a musician who's actually studying liturgical music right now. But my whole life has been this connection between loving my music and also my faith. And it's interesting how certain artists and certain things have actually made me enrich my faith. When I thought it was some like the spiritual, like for instance, mm-hmm. take for instance the Who's Tommy.
Oh yes, and the idea yes. That,
and Tommy is you know the story of Tommy, right?
Oh, very
and even
well, yeah.
Later on, and then even with Quadrophenia, there was a spiritual. And one of my favorite quotes, and I'm a big Beatles fan, is from George Harrison. Is he once said, "One must always be God conscious." And I always tell people that when I'm trying to approach them about faith, I said that's a good way of beginning. It says we have to understand that there's more to life than just being on this planet. We're more than just this body in this world that we see.
Yes.
And you also mentioned U2, and U2 is a very pivotal band because of the spiritual element in their music. And you know, I just was reading the description of your book, and I'm just like thinking to myself, this sounds like me. I mean, I may not have been a journalist, but people
great.
Tease me how crazy I am about music. But many people don't understand, and it's funny because even my daughter is like the same way. It's like she gets this connection. I don't feel it's a contradiction.
No, what about that connection, Don?
There is a connection, and you know, I think that there's a certain way of thinking that's been present in certain evangelical circles, not all, but some, and it's infiltrated some Catholics' thinking as well. Again, not all, but there's a certain way of thinking that rock and roll is simply the devil's music, and people talk about the beat and how you know the beat is a beat that gets the heart in a certain rate where one can only think about, you know, illicit things. I don't know. But, you know, I just find that in actual practice, even though there are some forms of rock and roll that are more conducive to godly thoughts than others, I mean, we can honestly say that. At the same time, there are secular arts that are not sinful in themselves, but can be elevated. I was reading a book written in the 1930s, 1936, by Father Daniel A. Lord, S.J., a wonderful evangelist for the faith. The book's called My European Diary, and he said that people who think of Catholics as being prudish would be shocked if they visited the Vatican museums, where there's all this ancient Roman art. I mean, the Vatican preserved all this classical art with all these nudes. Now, certainly there's a right way to do the nude in art, and there's a wrong way. And John Paul II, in his Catechesis on Human Love, the theology of the body, talks about the right and wrong way to depict the human body in art. But at the same time, the very fact that the Catholic Church preserved these pagan works of art shows that the Catholicism rejects nothing of what is good in other faiths or even in the secular world. And I believe that rock and roll qualifies as a true artistic form, which means that there are some, you know, some rock songs, rock bands, albums that can be part of a life that, that is God-centered.
Bert, how's that for you?
Yes.
Okay,
I'm
Bert.
Still here.
Yep, okay. Bert says yes. He approves.
Yeah, I just wanted to say.
Okay, go ahead,
I
Bert.
Just want to say, first off, I appreciate you getting me on because I have to start my shift. I'm a nurse, and I'm just getting ready to start my shift, so.
Well, God bless you. Do good as a nurse.
I always do. Before I go into work, I always say a prayer because I take my patient care very seriously. And I just, you know, but it's true. Sometimes when I'm having like a stressful night and I'm doing my charting, I listen to music and it somehow brings me right back to just being, okay, I'm calm, I'm good. So,
yeah. Beautiful.
You know, like I said, it's part of my life. It's part of my family's life. And I just blessings on you for what you've done with this book.
Thank
and I can
you.
Hardly wait to get my copy of it and read it. So
thanks, Bert.
Thank you so much, Bert. Thank you for calling. God bless you.
I have to say, when Bert was talking about Tommy and Quadrophenia, the entire millennial staff in here is looking around like they have no clue what that is.
Oh,
like,
no.
You might as well be talking about Mahler's Lost Symphony or so. There's no Lost Symphony.
They should prepare to have their minds blown by the music of Tommy. I recommend listening to the original album, which you can certainly find on YouTube. Listening to that before seeing the movie.
So you're becoming a Christian. You're living a secular life in New York City, and you're making your way as a rock journalist. My image is of a kind of hedonistic world. Is that what the world was like, or were you surprised by the people that you met and got to interview?
I'll tell you a story as far as my share in this hedonistic world. I was one of the original finalists, one of the finalists for the original cast of MTV's television show, The Real World, which, as you and I imagine and some listeners will know, was really one of the first reality shows back in the early 1990s. And I did not make it onto MTV's The Real World. And I think the reason why was that when I was being interviewed by video for it in the MTV offices, I was asked, what's a typical weekend for you? And I said, well, on Friday night, I'll probably go to a concert in a nightclub. And then on Saturday, I'll visit my mom. And on Sunday, I might go to a movie with my friend Luba. So I wouldn't say that my
Come
book
on.
Is a description of hedonistic times.
No, but to the degree that I do, Don, I wasn't expecting you to have been throwing televisions off the balcony of the hotel. But I just wanted to know if the people that you interviewed, was that the lifestyle that they were living, or did you find that you... that maybe they weren't. Maybe that was a pose in some ways of the rock and rollers.
Some of them definitely were. I won't name names, but yes.
Come on. Just kidding.
No,
sorry.
Sorry. This is a Catholic show, and I don't want to have to bring that material.
You're a better person than I am, Dawn. Okay. So some did.
But there were others whom I describe in Sunday Will Never Be the Same, who were, you know, themselves trying to find meaning to life in their way. One of the people I talk about in Sunday Will Never Be the Same is Del Shannon. Now, I interviewed him in 1989. Very sadly, the following year, he took his own life. He struggled with depression, with alcoholism, but he taught me something that helped me and still helps my faith life. He was saying that he was hoping for a new record deal, and there was this meeting that his manager was having with the BMG record label. And I, as an agnostic, said, "Well, I'll pray for that." And he said, "No, don't pray for that. Pray for God's will for me."
Oh, wow. Wow. Isn't that something? Well, we haven't talked about your conversion, and I'd like to hear some more about these people you interviewed, but I do want to get into the conversion, so we'll do that when we come back. Dawn Eden is the author of Sunday Will Never Be the Same. A rock and roll journalist opens her ears to God. We continue our conversation with her right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Join us on air today on Catholic Answers Live.
As Catholics, we hear expressions like dogma, doctrine, deposit of faith, and, of course, magisterium. And adding to the confusion, we have the ordinary magisterium and the extraordinary magisterium. So what if you were looking for one book written for the layman that explained what all these terms mean and how they interact in the lives of the Church and her faithful? The fact is, no such book existed until now. Brand new from Catholic Answers Press is Jimmy A. latest book, Teaching with Authority. Teaching with Authority is not about specific church teachings, it's about church teaching itself. A unique and long overdue resource for Catholics as well as those inquiring about the faith, Teaching with Authority will help deepen your understanding of what the church teaches by showing you how, why, and where she does. Get your copy of Teaching with Authority today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging onto the shop at Catholic.com or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
What are the basic teachings of Islam? How does the Quran compare with the Bible? Does Islam really encourage violence in God's name, or is it a religion of peace? In 20 Answers Islam, you'll find smart, solid answers to these questions and many more, taking a look inside Islam to reveal what its own theological authorities teach and cutting through the ignorance and wishful thinking that are too common in our culture. 20 Answers Islam is part of the 20 Answers series from Catholic Answers, offering hard facts, powerful arguments, and clear explanations of the most important topics facing the Church and the world, all in a compact, easy-to-read package. Visit shop.catholic.com and take a look at this exciting new series from Catholic Answers Press.
Have you subscribed to the Catholic Answers Radio Club newsletter? This is Catholic Answers Live host Cy Kellett, and I want to tell you about our new weekly newsletter full of behind-the-scenes information and facts you need to know about the show. It's easy to sign up. Just visit CatholicAnswersLive.com and look for the newsletter sign-up box on the front of the page. It's a great way to keep up to date with what's happening with the show and see what's coming in the days ahead, delivered weekly into your inbox. Sign up today for the Catholic Answers Radio Club newsletter and see what you've been missing. Go to CatholicAnswersLive.com.
Is the Church wrong on contraception? In a culture that worships the pursuit of sexual pleasure, the Catholic Church's teaching on contraception can seem archaic and unintelligible. Its critics say it's outdated, theologically unfounded, and even harmful. And even faithful Catholics can have difficulty explaining this moral teaching. Catholic Answers is out to change all of that. That's why we've just released Trent Horn's dynamic new DVD, The Case Against Contraception. Using scripture, papal and magisterial teachings, natural law, and new insights provided by social science and medicine, Trent puts forward a compelling case for Catholic teachings with his trademark charity and persuasive graciousness. Be prepared to give a defense. Order your copy of The Case Against Contraception today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging onto the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
What difference does it make who or what you worship or what you believe? Sharing the faith used to make some people mad because it challenged their own strong beliefs. Today, it makes a lot of people yawn because they don't have strong beliefs about anything. Religious indifference is the great spiritual sickness of our age, a product of the relativism that dominates modern culture. This is Matt Nelson, and in my new book, Just Whatever, I'll take down the building blocks of religious indifference one by one. We'll look at the different kinds of indifference you tend to encounter in your friends and family members to see where they come from and why they're seductive. What you believe matters. Find out why and what to do about it in my new book, Just Whatever. You can order your copy of Just Whatever by calling 1-888-291-8000, by visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Sunday will never be the same. That is the title of Don Eden Goldstein's brand new book from Catholic Answers Press. It's a rock and roll journalist. It's her memoir of opening her ears to God. It's kind of a different turn for Catholic Answers Press. We usually publish a certain kind of book, and this is a more narrative book than we usually publish. And I don't know if we've ever published a memoir before. We may have, but
you published Cardinal Newman's memoir.
Oh, well, Cardinal Newman, I mean, is of a living person, okay?
So, he's alive. He's a saint. He's alive in heaven.
Oh, okay. Well, okay. That is Don Eden Goldstein, a theologian as well, a doctor in theology, explaining to me how the resurrection works, no, how life after death works. But she wasn't always a theologian. She wasn't always a Catholic. She wasn't always a Christian. She wasn't even always an agnostic secularist. She was. She came into this world to a Jewish family, was bat mitzvahed in the Jewish faith, became a rock and roller. As a matter of fact, you went to college in New York City, I believe.
Yes, you went there.
No, but you went there because you wanted to be close to a certain kind of rock and roll scene in New York.
That's absolutely right. Yes.
And that worked out for you. Because you have this talent as a writer, so you start by transcribing, if I'm not wrong, interview, and then you and you move into writing. I suppose it's interesting. It must have been a benefit in a certain way that the kind of music that you were attracted to was a small world at that time. It wasn't.
Yes.
It wasn't like you were trying to break into writing about IBM or something. You were writing about something that you loved, that was precious to you, but was also very local.
Yes, that's right. It was a time when one really could be a big fish in a small pond. I think it's very hard for people nowadays to imagine what it was like to be a fan of independent label music, even before people were really using the word indie to describe indie labels. I think it's hard for people to understand what it was like to be a fan of that music back when there weren't websites and social media sites to have these little niches where you could be into your particular subgroup of music, but where if you were into something that was underground, music that was not played on the radio, you had to read fanzines to learn about what was going on. And fanzines were homemade magazines at a time before computers, where people had to buy rub-off letters that you used a pencil to rub off to make headlines. And you had to actually use a typewriter to create these fanzines.
Isn't that great? So entrepreneurial and ingenious,
yes,
the way people did it. Okay, so that's how you started writing.
Yes, it is. I started writing for fanzines. And I remember the thrill when I would go to a nightclub and someone would say, I saw your interview with the Fleshtones in the Bomb, or something like that.
Yeah, that's what wonderful validation for a young person. So you're going to college, and then on the weekends, this detail in your book, and this is one of the great things that any very fine writer will do, will provide these details. But this is one I'm not sure how I feel about. You would put on white lipstick, and was that was that the look at the time, or what was that about?
And I learned at some point that white lipstick is supposed to be blended with other colors, But, you know, at first, I just saw photos of models from the 60s with the raccoon eyes and the false eyelashes and the actual white lipstick.
Right.
And I thought, well, that's a look. And, you know, unfortunately, I also had a silver lipstick that I absolutely loved. And now there are videos of me on YouTube where I interview rock bands such as Guided by Voices, where I'm wearing the silver lipstick, and it looks awful. And the funny thing is that there
Yeah, you're the only person who looked awful in the 80s. Everyone else looked great.
Oh my gosh. Well, this was actually 2000, and I was still and I was still wearing silver lipstick. But, and the funny thing is that I was doing that Manhattan Cable video show for many years, and you'd think that at some point over a span of like 5-10 years, I would have figured out not to wear silver lipstick. But to me, it was the mod look, and that was the look that I wanted, the mod 60s look.
So tell us about some of the people that you interviewed and the impression that that left on you and how that was also an education for you.
It was very much an education. Well, I'll tell you one of the stories that I tell in Sunday Will Never Be the Same about this songwriter whose music I loved named John Carter. And among the songs he wrote that you and other listeners might know is Herman's Hermits, Can't You Hear My Heartbeat? A song that was a one-hit wonder in the United States by a group called the Music Explosion from Ohio. The song was called Little Bit of Soul. You'd recognize, you know, the guitar into a dun-dun-dun-dun, dun-dun-dun-dun.
Oh, yeah, yes, yeah.
So there was a time when I was going to London, and one of the things I was going to do there was meet this songwriter, John Carter. And a friend of mine, who was not, you know, I didn't know him to be particularly a Christian. He was a fellow rock fan. He said, well, you know that Little Bit of Soul is a Christian song. And I said, oh, come on. You know, it's a groovy mod garage dance number.
Yeah.
That's not a Christian song. That's not how Christian songs sound. And he said, no, but there's this line, you got to make like you're on your knees and pray, and then a little bit of soul will come your way. And I said, oh, no, that's just some you know, reference to a dance move where you get on your knees. I don't know. So then I actually met John Carter, and John Carter was, you know, typical Englishman, you know, fairly secular. And so I was almost, you know, embarrassed. I was embarrassed to say this to him, but just so that I could tell my friend Scott back home that I had mentioned this, and proved to Scott, you know, from the horse's mouth, so to speak, that he was wrong. I said to John Carter, you want to know something crazy? My friend Scott back home says that Little Bit of Soul is a Christian song. And he said, oh, yes, it is. I was like, you're putting me on. You're like, what is this, April Fool's Day? Come on. And he said, no, really. And it turned out that he was working with a lyricist named Ken Lewis, who was Christian. And Ken Lewis wrote the lyrics to Little Bit of Soul as an experiment to see if he could get an explicitly Christian song into the pop charts. And so now all those lyrics make sense. You know, when you're feeling low and the fish won't bite, you need a little bit of soul to put you right. Those lyrics from the gospel. I mean, basically expressions of the gospel. So that was, you know, one of those, you know, moments for me where I didn't realize it at the time, but looking back, I can see that was God trying to break through.
Isn't that something, a Christian kind of as an infiltrator into the secular pop. That's something you even see an artist like Mel Gibson in a certain way. It's the same thing. It's an infiltration because they're presenting something that. I don't know about Gibson. I mean, it's more explicit in his case, I guess. But in this case, the beauty of the gospel is people will recognize it as long as you don't present it as the gospel, because they've already decided that's not for me.
Right, right.
We got a bunch of people want to talk to you, Dawn. Let me mention again Dawn's brand new book, a memoir, Sunday Will Never Be the Same, A Rock and Roll Journalist Opens Her Ears to God. It's available now from Catholic Answers Press. And anybody who gets through this hour, if you just hang on the line and give us your address, we'll send you a free copy of Dawn's book because, you know, we want to cheat her out of the royalties. Eddie in Cincinnati, listening on Sacred Heart Radio, you are up first this hour with Dawn Eden Goldstein. Your question, Eddie.
Hi, this is Eddie. Dawn, I was raised on mostly what you wrote about, like, that was all, you know, that was my MTV, you know, and into the 70s past the Beatles and the rest of it, Zeppelin and U2, as you mentioned, but there was one artist that ran true, and he actually got the Nobel Prize for lyrics, and that was Dylan. About his seventh album, he put out Saved, okay, so... I don't think that was fake, you know, like a lot of these things you were talking about, you know, sort of hinting at God, you know.
So you're saying that Dylan became a Christian, and his seventh album, the name of the album was Saved?
Yes.
Okay.
Wasn't his seventh album, but yes, it was called Saved. He made three Christian albums.
Okay, and that happened out here on the West Coast, right? It was kind of the... There's a thing out here called the Jesus Movement, which was born out of the hippie movement, and then now it's very stable in many ways. It's become kind of very common that there are these Christian churches whose pastors were former hippies and all that. So that's kind of where Dylan got his exposure, if I'm not wrong.
I'm not sure about that. Dylan was evangelized by members from a kind of a mega church in L.A. I wrote an article about it, which I don't remember the title, but I wrote it just, I think, last year. You can find it online if you just search for Dawn Eden Goldstein and Bob Dylan. I wrote it for the Los Angeles Archdiocese magazine Angelus, and it's a review of the Dylan gospel box set that has the music, Eddie, that you're describing. And, you know, one of the points that is made in the liner notes of that box set, and that I certainly believe, is that Dylan was absolutely sincere. I think there were certain fans who just couldn't conceive of someone of Dylan's artistic, you know, caliber and intelligence being Christian, and those people claimed that he was faking, but he wasn't. And you know, I think, and certainly, you know, if Bishop Robert Barron were on this show, I think he would agree that even though Dylan has left behind making explicitly Christian music, that he remains most definitely God-haunted, Christ-haunted, and contrary to what some people have said, he has not disavowed Christ. He has, you know, broken away from that particular church, but he's not denied the Christian faith that he expressed on those albums.
I can tell you just about any album that came from the 60s or 70s. And now you know the fame of the Beatles and the fame of the Rolling Stones. And still these rock bands march on, and they won't. They're not going to change. They're certainly not going to start singing gospel, you know. But
well, the Rolling Stones have sung gospel on occasion.
Yeah.
I think you have to really... Eddie, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, but I think that part of being Christian is always having hope for people's conversion. I mean, you know, forgive me, I don't want to be rude, but God forbid that when I was far from the Lord, if everybody was just saying, oh, well, Dawn's never going to change, she's never going to be Christian, if they then didn't pray for me, even if it seems hopeless, we have to keep praying for the conversion of the Rolling Stones, for the conversion of this Paul McCartney and Ringo Starr. You know, Paul comes from a Catholic family, so we want to pray him home, and so on. I mean, that's what being Christian is about. It's about, you know, and being a Catholic is all about knowing that God wills that everyone be saved, and as Catholics, we know that God wants us to cooperate with His will through prayer for that intention.
Eric, thank you very, very much for that call. I am sorry we'll have to leave it there because we got to take a break. Stay on the line, all those on the line. I know I've been making you wait. A lot of people want to talk to you now, Dawn. The book is Sunday Will Never Be the Same. The author is our guest this hour, Dawn Eden Goldstein. It's a memoir of how she came to the Christian faith and to the Catholic faith. In some ways, through her life as a rock journalist. So I want to read a little something to you, Dawn, and I want folks to know you can get the book right now at shop.catholic.com. As a matter of fact, you can get it for 15% off because everything there is 15% off right now if you just use the promo code SPRING19 when you go to shop.catholic.com. But Kathy wrote us this note. I just completed your book. This is to you, Dawn, and was hooked from the very beginning. I love the way you write and how you very gently told your story in all its sadness and craziness. I was a child teen of the 60s and early 70s and lover of rock and roll, but I also knew God growing up in a church that had a strong youth group and read my Bible daily. However, I was still deceived by the devil, taking me to my mid-20s to turn to the truth. I came into the church in my early 30s thanks to a devout Catholic grandmother-in-law who prayed for me daily once I married her grandson. I have begun sharing your book with friends and family. I would love to hear you speak, so please come to New Jersey, Atlantic County. God bless you, Kathy.
Wow.
Isn't that nice?
It is. It's really beautiful. And, you know, I'm just grateful to know that it's first of all a book, that Sunday Will Never Be the Same. I'm grateful to know that it's making an impact on readers like Kathy and that it's helping them, you know, in some way to see God's action of grace in their own lives. That's really why I wrote it.
Dawn Goldstein is our guest. Again, go to shop.catholic.com right now. You can get the book, Sunday Will Never Be the Same, or you can just call us. We're giving it away free. The lines are full, so you might not get in. Eric, again, thank you for that. That was Eddie. Sorry, Eddie. Thank you. Eric, we'll get to you next. We'll be right back with more on Catholic Answers Live.
Hello, everyone. This is country music artist Colin Ray. Do what I do and keep it right here on Catholic Answers Live.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Catholic Answers Live is brought to you in part by CatholicSingles.com, the website for Catholics who want to meet others who share their Catholic values for faith, fellowship, and love. You can learn more at CatholicSingles.com. Catholic Answers Live thanks CatholicSingles.com for their generous support.
The leading Catholic voices are on EWTN Radio.
We do our best to keep you, well, connected to all the events happening in our one holy Catholic and apostolic faith, from Rome to back home here in the U.S. and around the globe. It's also our goal to help each and every listener like you take this beautiful faith of ours out into the public square with great ideas on making a difference through engaging the culture.
Catholic Connection with Teresa Tomeo. Tomorrow morning, 9 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Sunday Will Never Be the Same. That's the brand new book from Dawn Eden Goldstein, our guest. Dawn is a writer of several books on to help folks who have faced the trauma of sexual abuse or other traumas. Give us the names of those two books, Dawn.
Sure. My Peace I Give You, Healing Sexual Wounds with the Help of the Saints, and Remembering God's Mercy, which is more generally for anyone seeking healing from pain from the past.
And now the memoir of Dawn's own life, which tells her own story, and it is there is a great sadness in it, as I guess any fully human life would have in it. And I wasn't sure about the word craziness that Kathy put in there, but I guess there is a little craziness in there as well, and a wonderful coming home story about coming home to the Catholic faith as well. Sunday will never be the same. Let us go back to the phones for Dr. Goldstein. We go now to Eric in Cincinnati. Eric is listening on Sacred Heart Radio. Your question for Dawn.
Hi. Hi, how are you?
Doing well, thank you. How are you?
Good. I was curious just about your... being a convert coming to the Catholic Church, it seems like you very much have found your vocation in many ways. I didn't know how that process was, if you had any, if there was anything particular you could share or even advice. I've been a Catholic myself for close to eight years now, coming
Welcome
up to Easter. I still don't always feel like I necessarily, I don't know, I go to Mass, but that's it. You know, and I know I have certain, limitations as far as my personal life, family. I'm a single dad. I have full custody only recently.
But you still feel, Eric, like you're searching for your vocation.
Correct.
Okay.
And we're, sometimes wanting to do more than just show up at Mass. And,
Yeah. Dawn, any insights?
Sure. Well, first of all, again, welcome home and thank you for all you do as a single dad. I mean, that's very important. And that really is a vocation when you're a parent of children. As far as going deeper into the faith, what helped me was reading, and certainly, some of the great reading is from the apologetics that Catholic Answers has. I was just looking at the Amazon reviews for Why We're Catholic by Trent Horn, and I was seeing that a lot of readers, they say that helped them to understand a lot of things about their own Catholic faith that they never understood before. For me, I love spiritual reading, so I love anything by Archbishop Fulton J. Sheen. Anything at all. Well, maybe except for Footprints in the Sand, but I bet if I read that, I'd love that too. But really, I mean, Fulton Sheen wrote books like Peace of Soul, P-E-A-C-E of Soul, which I highly recommend. He wrote a booklet that you can easily find called Calvary and the Mass. And his writing is spiritually rich, also very accessible. I can tell you, as someone who's written about theology and tried to write popular books, that if I'm trying to write something and then I read something by Fulton J. Sheen, on the one hand, it inspires me because his writing is so beautiful, but on the other hand, it can lead me to despair, just wanting to hang up my pen, because for me, I don't know how to say things without going into kind of layers of metacritical analysis, whereas Fulton Sheen uses language that's as simple as the gospel and so very powerful. Now, other ways to go deeper into the faith, my mother listens to the audio rosary. If you go to YouTube and you look at the different YouTube recordings of rosaries and also the Divine Mercy Chaplet, some of them are very beautiful. There's also the Magnificat magazine, which also has an app, I believe, or an online version, and that has readings for daily prayer. Different things. Another thing that helps me is just going to a cemetery once a week and praying the rosary for the holy souls, because we believe that we on earth are united with those who are waiting to get into heaven, and that since they can't pray for themselves, they need our prayers. And that's an inspiring thing that enriches my faith life. So do any of those things help?
Yeah, I'll give them a shot. I do have my own devotions, or I flip around and try different devotions, but sometimes, and I don't know if it's just because of my particular slant of, a Protestant sect I had come from, but I feel like as far as, like, what I'm contributing, I can take in knowledge, and maybe it's just where, I feel like because prayers aren't in a visible action, and maybe
prayers are spiritual works of mercy. Please, when you're off the line, read about the spiritual works of mercy. They're genuine works. Dorothy Day talked about them, and she's someone worth reading about too, that who might inspire you.
If I may just offer, Dawn, as a father too, and now in my 50s, that there is a time when you can feel in the raising of children like I'm just not doing enough. But you have that vocation for then. Free time does come where you can devote yourself more to prayer or to sitting with Christ in the Eucharist or doing other works, that kind of thing. So parenting is a uniquely kind of a time vortex, or I don't know what the right word is, and you just have to be patient with yourself. So I don't want to insert myself too much, but I do have that experience as a father that it does change.
Thank you.
Thank you. God bless you.
Thanks, Eric. Let us go to Rylene in San Jose, California, listening on the Catholic Answers app. Rylene, your question or comment for Dawn Eden Goldstein.
Hi, Rylene.
Hi, Dawn. I don't know if you remember me, but I have.
I sure do. I only know one Rylene in the whole world, and I admire you so much.
Oh, thank you so much. This is kind of a personal question. Pardon my laryngitis. But I have met you, and my impression of you is that you're a pretty darn shy person. And maybe that impression is wrong, but...
Rylene, I apologize to you. I did not time it very well. We are going to take a quick break. Rylene, will you hold on and just finish that thought with Dawn when we come back?
Sure, of course.
Oh, okay, thank you very much. Dawn Eden Goldstein is our guest. Her brand new memoir, Sunday Will Never Be the Same, is available now from Catholic Answers Press. Right back with more after this.
Catholic Answers Live.
Tim Staples, Trent Horn, Cy Kellett, Chris Check, Carlo Broussard. Our On Fire lineup of speakers will inform and inspire your audience to grow in their Catholic faith. For more information on booking a Catholic Answers speaker for your event, visit CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com today.
Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" Turns out that today, as back then, this question has a lot of different answers. So many groups want to appropriate Jesus, tweaking his identity until he looks and sounds just like one of them. But then you no longer have the Lord, says apologist Trent Horn. You have an imposter. In his new groundbreaking book, Counterfeit Christ, Trent exposes 18 phony versions of Jesus that we encounter today, helping you to recognize the fakes when you see them, explain why they're phony, and make a case for the full truth and beauty of who Jesus is, the Christ, the Son of the living God. Order your copy of Counterfeit Christ today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Love and beauty. As a little girl, Dawn Eden Goldstein knew that she wanted those things, that in them somehow she would find God. Over the years as a rock journalist, she moved among some of popular music's best-known artists, straining to capture that transcendent love and beauty in every note and lyric. In Sunday Will Never Be the Same, Dawn recounts her spiritual journey in beautifully wrought detail, mixing powerful accounts of trauma, healing, and epiphany with funny anecdotes from inside the music scene. It is the rare conversion story that delights as it inspires, amuses as it edifies, and ultimately lays before the reader a lived testimony to the transforming grace of Christ. Order your copy of Sunday Will Never Be the Same by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Rylene from San Jose, I had to cut her off, and I apologize for that. She's listening on the Catholic Answers app, which, by the way, you can download onto your phone. Go ahead and download that Catholic Answers app. You can get us wherever you go. Our guest is Dawn Eden Goldstein. Her book, Sunday Will Never Be the Same. And Rylene, you were just in the middle of a conversation with Dawn, and I had to cut you off. Go ahead and finish.
Yeah, sure. So I guess my impression of you, Dawn, is that you're a shy person, and it's hard, and I might be wrong about that, right? But, so tell me if I am, but I just have a hard time picturing you overcoming that shyness and inserting yourself into the rock and roll world as, you know, somebody who's, I guess I envision it as kind of having to push your way into the backstage and get, you know, 10 minutes with a star or something like that. So how did you, if you are shy, how did you overcome that to kind of follow your dream in this area?
That's a wonderful question, Rylene. And the answer is, yes, I am shy, but I didn't know that I was shy until late in adulthood. I always thought that I was an exhibitionist and an extrovert. It wasn't until I started to learn about the actual definition of introvert versus extrovert that I realized that, yes, I am shy. And so I think that the sort of aggressiveness with which I did, you know, go backstage and so on, was just that if you want something badly enough, you do it even if it goes against it takes you out of your comfort zone. So, yeah, I am a very sensitive person, and I, you know, get hurt easily. But there are a few things that, you know, bother me more than thinking, well, you know, what if I had made that extra effort, and which I didn't make, you know, would something have happened differently? So I tend to feel like I've got to make every effort to achieve, or, you know, the things that I want to achieve, you know, rather than have those regrets. And of course, you know, part of the journey of a lifetime now for me as a Catholic is learning, you know, what Pope Francis wisely speaks about discernment in terms of learning, you know, what things are actually worth striving after to achieve, and what things should one refrain from, you know, trying to push one's way through. So thank you it's a great question.
Oh, well, so I have to say, so that's great. It seems like a great rule for life. You know, if you want something badly enough, you'll push through it.
My mother told me. My mother told me from when I was a child, two things she said that that influenced me a lot. The first one was if you want something, ask for it. So that became a kind of a mantra. You know, if I want the interview with this musician, I have to ask for the interview with this musician, and all kinds of other things. Another thing she said to me, which, you know, sounds kind of, you know, a bit gross, but one can still say it on a family radio station, is spit doesn't fall from the cellar. And the context is that as a child, I used to complain about mistreatment at the hands of teachers or principals or what have you, because I was smart and I was cocky, and I also had certain, you know, psychological problems that I now understand from the wounds of abuse that I didn't understand then. But I would complain to Mom about my teachers, and she would say, spit doesn't fall from the cellar, meaning you go through school and you get your education and you get to a certain place of authority, and then you can affect positive change. You know, until or unless you do the hard work of working your way up to a position of authority and earning that authority as well, it's not about, you know, raw power, but it's about working hard for a positive goal. You know, until you can do that, you know, it doesn't help to complain. And I think that's, you know, within the context of a parent teaching godly morality, I think that can be a godly message.
For sure. All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Rylene.
Thank you so much. It's great hearing your voice. God bless you.
Again, Donnie Goldstein, our guest this hour. We're talking about her brand new book for Catholic Answers Press, Sunday Will Never Be the Same. A rock and roll journalist opens her ears to God. You can get it right now at shop.catholic.com. And everybody who calls in this hour and gets on the air with Don is getting a free copy. Let's go to Ricky in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, listening on AM 1380. Ricky, you're...
Hi, Ricky.
Hi, how y'all doing?
Very well.
Doing well, thank you.
Good deal. And a related subject, I've kind of gotten, I guess, infatuated with going back and looking at old movies and TV shows that, you know, I saw as a kid but didn't appreciate things. Mm-hmm. And I started seeing this trend in old shows, some of the old 40s and 50s movies, and then things like Gunsmoke and, you know, the Virginian, Big Valley, and all these things. I said, man, these people are writing like they're Catholic. And just coincidentally, a week or two ago, I think it was might have been an Al Cresta, there was someone talking about this Father Daniel Lard, who had written the Code of Film Ethics back in the 20s and 30s that basically set out, you know, the rules and guidelines of how to portray people. And, you know, some people eventually found out subversively, you know, they found out that they felt like there was subversion going on, that here's a Catholic person writing, you know, a priest writing the code for, you know, the film industry, which was controlled by the Jewish people, and it was mostly being presented to the Protestant world. And it was just like the light bulb went on, and just it seemed like there's a big opportunity for someone to do some investigating on, you know, how that influenced the culture, as well as the actors and writers that were involved, and how all of that kind of, you know, permeated society.
Well, you know, it's an interesting topic. I would, you know, correct you, you know, one thing by saying that Hollywood has never been homogeneously run by Jewish people, you know, and you know, we have to be kind of careful about talking about that, because there are some, and believe me, I'm not accusing you of this at all, but there are some anti-Semitic tropes that people use sometimes when speaking about Hollywood that involve such generalization. So, you know, I'm sure that's not what you meant, but just wanted to say we have to be careful about our way of describing things. But what is interesting is that when Hollywood had to censor itself, it turned to a Jesuit priest, Father Daniel A. Lord, S.J. And the story behind that is that Congress, having cracked down on the comic book industry, then set its sights on the film industry. And actually, I could have my timing wrong. The comic book industry could have come later, but I think I've got it right. Congress was about to enact its own strictures upon Hollywood films to prevent them from being, you know, offensive and corrupting morals. And Hollywood much rather wanted to have its own self-censorship than to have state-imposed censorship. So, since Father Daniel A. Lord had already had some Hollywood experience as a consultant to Cecil B. DeMille on King of Kings, Joseph Breen, who, if I remember correctly, was a Hollywood producer involved with the Motion Picture Association of America, basically commissioned Father Lord to write this code, which served Hollywood very, very well for many years, until Eli Kazan's film Baby Doll and other Hollywood films pushed the envelope so hard that the code collapsed, and there was no longer a moral consensus among Americans in the 1960s to restore the code.
We will leave it there because I got to take a quick break. Don Eden Goldstein is our guest, and her book, Sunday Will Never Be the Same, from Catholic Answers Press, is available right now. Let's take a break. We'll be right back with more of your calls and questions for Don right after this.
We're here for you. Call now. Catholic Answers Live.
We need
EDWTN Radio, for the reason that Mother Angelica founded this entire enterprise, she always saw this as a spiritual growth network. It was to be an enterprise in media that reached people in all aspects of their life. She saw this as a holistic approach to reaching the whole person in the middle of the world and bringing them truth and life.
Raymond Arroyo thinks Catholic radio is important. So should you.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections' website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Pope Francis reminds us that it does not take a specialized degree in theology to become a great evangelist. We're all called to evangelize. Think about the woman at the well. After she encountered Jesus, she immediately went into the city and invited others to meet him as she had. You and I can go out now and do the same. And St. Paul Street Evangelization can help. Get involved today by contacting us at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Don Eden Goldstein, our guest, that a whole bunch of people want to talk to you, Don, so I'm just going to let them do that. But I will remind the listener, the occasion for having Don here with us is the publication of her memoir by the Catholic Answers Press. Sunday Will Never Be the Same. A rock and roll journalist opens her ears to God. One of the things when I first opened it up, one of my favorite things was each chapter. I don't know if you know about this, Don, but each chapter is named after a rock and roll song. Were you aware of that?
You don't know if I know about that?
Nah, I'm just teasing you. I know you knew it. Scott.
That's my book.
Scott in Dallas, Texas, listening on Guadalupe Radio. You are up next, Scott. Your question for Don Eden Goldstein.
Hi, Dr. Goldstein. My question is, it sounds like from what I heard, you used to be an atheist. So my question
an agnostic.
Before you became a Christian, did you have inner peace? And now that you are a Christian, do you have inner peace?
That's a great question. The first part of that question is very easy to answer. In one word, no, I did not have inner peace. And in Sunday Will Never Be the Same, I talk about the wounds that I had, the longing, and how I sought God in things that were not God. Some of the things I sought God in had genuine beauty, like music, but they couldn't satisfy my desire for an infinite love. With respect to, do I have inner peace now? I would say yes and no. Yes, I have inner peace in that I'm not going anywhere beyond the church. I found Jesus Christ in his church, and so there's no longer any desire to go outside of my I don't want to just say membership, because that sounds like it's rules-based, but there's no reason to go outside my life in the church as a member of the baptized and as one who receives the Eucharist in communion with other Catholics and through my baptism in communion with Christians throughout the world. And certainly I have greater peace emotionally, spiritually, psychologically than I did before I was a Catholic. But with respect to the no, you know, we're not supposed to be completely satisfied in this life. That's something you'll find in Augustine at the beginning of his Confessions, where he says, Lord, you have made us for yourself, and our hearts are restless until they rest in you. And it's in Jesus' own Sermon on the Mount, where he says, blessed are they who hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. So if we're not hungry in this life, if we're not thirsting, something's wrong. If you hear from a Christian who says that they've got such prosperity
that there's nothing more that they could want, run. Just run, because that is not Christianity. That's the what's called the prosperity gospel, which is not the gospel of Jesus Christ.
Amen to that.
So in that sense, no, I don't have inner peace, but I have a taste of the inner peace that is going to be fulfilled in the next life, and I believe that. Praise God.
Scott, does that answer satisfy you?
It sounds really good. Listen, when I tell people that I have the Lord, I say He gave me peace. Well, I'm working towards peace. I feel like I'm lying, but as a disciple of Christ, we're supposed to have peace, period. I mean, we're supposed to. I'm working towards that, but like you say, if I don't have peace, I kind of feel embarrassed that I don't.
But so that is exactly Don's point. This world is not our home.
Yes, we're supposed to be restless while we're here, and you know where it says in the gospel, Jesus says, "Forgive 70 times 7," and there are some people who interpret that as meaning that we may have to forgive 70 times 7 the same person in the same day, as often as we, you know, feel that grudge, we forgive. Well, likewise with peace, Jesus says, "My peace I give you, not as the world gives, do I give it to you?" Well, when the world gives, the world says, "Here you go, run with it, just take it, okay, get gone, next." Whereas Jesus gives us His peace, and then we come back and we say, "Okay, Jesus, I need more peace." And He says, "Here's more peace." And then we come back and we say, "Okay, Jesus, that wasn't enough, I still need more peace," and so on. And that is the life of the Christian.
Scott, thank you very much for that call. I hope that was helpful to you. Sunday Will Never Be the Same is the name of the book. Don Egan Goldstein is our guest, and we go now to Joe in Columbus, South Carolina. Joe, your question for Don.
Hey, how y'all doing? Great show.
Doing well. Thank you.
Don, I wanted to ask you about the song Let It Be by Paul McCartney you were talking earlier. And my understanding of that song from him was that came about from a dream he had where his mother, who was, a Catholic midwife, spoke to him, but he doesn't consider it a direct reference to the Blessed Mother. But the song, to me, is so imbued with, you know, the title, Let It Be, is the fiat and the
yes.
whole imagery of Mary in the song. I was just kind of wondering what your take is, if maybe Mr. McCartney doesn't fully understand what was being communicated to him in sort of the muses of that song.
I agree completely. Paul McCartney tells the story just like you said. I didn't realize his mother was a midwife. I didn't know that he came from a Catholic family. But you know, I don't doubt you on that. It's just news to me. He told the story recently on the popular series Carpool Karaoke, oh, yeah. That one can find, it's a beautiful story, and I think that you've articulated it perfectly, where a song that has goodness in it can take on a life of its own beyond what the person may have intended. And who knows but that Paul McCartney may have been in some way channeling, you know, from his subconscious, a memory of you know, as a child, hearing that gospel of Mary saying, "Be it done unto me according to thy word," and who knows too that maybe, you know, since he says he had that dream, we should believe him, but maybe also his mother Mary was giving him the wisdom of Mary and wanted to impart that to him.
I like to think that, and certainly like to. And he says he has no problem with people interpreting it as the Blessed Mother, in a sense, in that song. And so maybe there is the Catholic ethos has a way of sort of sneaking into things, especially
yes,
if you've grown
yes.
up in that environment. But anyway, thank you for your reflection on that.
Joe, I hope you enjoy the book.
I
hope you enjoy Sunday's. Sunday Will Never Be the Same, Don's book. Thank you so much for that call. Let's go to Sean in Sydney, Australia, just waking
Sean,
up.
Hello. Good morning.
Good night.
Hi, Sean.
Good morning to you. No, I just sort of thought I'd listen in because the question I've got, right through going to a Christopher West series of talks at World Youth Day back in 2008, where he's talking about music and looking at lyrics and comparing it to theology of the body questions and people, you know, looking for love and all that. Right?
Okay.
Yes, I was at that same World Youth Day. I remember hearing about that talk because I was speaking there too.
Oh, okay, awesome. So you've been down under?
Yes, yes, love it. I want to come back.
Oh, do it. But what I wanted to ask really is, to what extent do you see within the modern music industry a lot of artists looking for God as opposed to the devil? I mean, you know, you think of Australian rock bands, classic one that comes to mind is AC/DC, and one of their, you know, trademark line songs is Highway to Hell, which is probably more theologically accurate than a lot of Christian worship music, I must say.
That's a good point.
right.
but it's like, to what extent do you actually see a lot of music artists in general looking for God rather than looking for the devil?
Well, I would say certainly if you listen to another great Australian band, the Bee Gees, you hear a lot of songs about looking for God, and it's interesting. I've heard from one source that they may have had some Catholicism in their background. It's hard to find that, but I did see that Robin Gibb, when he was dying, his wife brought a Catholic priest to his bedside, so he received the sacrament of the sick. Yes, I think that with many bands, you hear a straining after something that is very beautiful that seems just out of reach, and that's a universal feeling. And I think that whether people who write, you know, those songs, express those feelings, know it or not, they are expressing in their way a longing for God.
Sean?
Yes?
That's what you were referring to.
Yeah, kind of. I mean, because, you know, Christopher West in this particular talk is pulling up lots of examples from U2, from probably from the Beatles, from various other ones. I don't remember them all, but I just remember him talking down this concept. And, I definitely see that in my favorite band, which is also from San Diego, Switchfoot. But they're
Switchfoot.
None of those guys are Christians.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Well, this is the condition of the modern world, though, isn't it, Don, that Sean is describing? The condition of the modern world is being stuck in the secular and longing for the divine.
Yes, that is, and that's really, you know, a major reason why I wrote Sunday Will Never Be the Same, because I feel that many people who are fans of pop music, of rock and roll, feel that their very appreciation of this music necessarily puts them outside the Christian world because they're not listening to Christian rock.
Right.
And I wanted to show how God's grace can reach us even through music that isn't explicitly Christian.
Never underestimate God's grace. That's bad policy, I think. Patrick, you are up next to your question for Don Eden Goldstein.
Hi, Patrick.
Hi, Don. Shout out from St. Joseph Parish, Manhattan.
Okay. Nice. Hello. It's St. Joe's on 4th Street.
Yep. I think if you tell people the story of how you got fired from the New York Post, people will run out and buy your book. So let me get out of the way and let you tell the story.
Oh, my gosh. Okay, I have to tell it in like 90 seconds, right? Because
yeah, you do. As a matter of fact, yeah.
The program. I was a convert to Protestant Christianity, church shopping, not happy in any one denomination, started to become convinced of the truth of the dignity of human life from conception to natural death, and I was looking at the New York Post and was given a story to copy edit that was not pro-life, and I made a change to it that made it pro-life. I was not authorized to make this change. I got caught. I apologized, and after I apologized, the reporter was just so furious at me that she started to print up pages from my blog, The Dawn Patrol, where I was writing against Planned Parenthood. And once the Post realized that they had this quote-unquote, you know, radical, right-wing, anti-abortion conservative on their editorial staff, that was when the then editor-in-chief fired me. But that was also when God's grace entered my life in a miraculous way through the intercession of St. Maximilian Kolbe that led me to make the decision to become Catholic. So for any more, I'm afraid you'll have to read the copy of my memoir, Sunday Will Never Be the Same, that will be reaching you as a free gift for calling in. But thank you for remembering that. That was a profoundly important time of my life.
Okay, great. I already own the book.
Oh, good for you, Patrick.
Gosh, you'll have one to give away. Thank you.
I'm so glad that Patrick asked about that, because I had forgotten that you actually the circumstances under which you departed, and it's a wonderful story. You radical, standing up for little babies. What kind of radical right-wing nonsense is that? Donnie Goldstein, 2 hours. You're a hero. You did it. I really appreciate you doing 2 hours with us. I still feel like I got about a million questions I'd love to ask you. But let me just
have me on again.
Okay. All right. Nicely done. Right on the air where I can't say no. That's not really true. Sunday Will Never Be the Same is Eden Goldstein's wonderful new memoir. The subtitle, A Rock and Roll Journal. Opens her ears to God. She'll help you open yours to God as well. So don't miss out on your opportunity to get a copy of Sunday Will Never Be the Same. Again, many, many thanks, Don. And we will do it again tomorrow. 2 hours of open forum. Jimmy Akin, Father John Trigilio. See you then, God willing.